Okay, why don't we start? Thanks for coming to Linux Fest. I know there's nothing you'd rather be doing on a sunny day in Dallas than being here thinking about securing those things. At any rate, my name is David Zuba. The sea is silent. My dad survived World War II for me to be here, so why not? I work for Benchmark Document Solutions. It's company down on Chestnut Street near the Farmer's Market, right across from La Fiamma Pizza. We sell and service Xerox equipment and postage meters and whatnot. Just full disclosure, I'm not here for Xerox. I'm not here for my boss. I got permission to take this piece of equipment, so I'm not making any money. None of us are by being here today. So it's because of your interest in security, right? I'm not going to plug Xerox one bit. Every device that looks like that is equally susceptible to what I'm going to talk about today. I'm a service tech, first and foremost. I get in under the hood and fix hardware, but I'm also in very much into the operating system and so on. It also says analyst and trainer, so I train users on how to be smart about their equipment, get the most out of their capital expense there, because these things, you know, just one of these little things can cost, you know, $5,000, and console pieces that sit on the floor with wheels can cost, you know, $20,000, sometimes $50,000. So we're not talking about small potatoes when an organization invests in multifunction devices. Oh yeah, by the way, we're not talking about refrigerators with video displays in them. We're not talking about microwaves that also send information back on the internet to, you know, Samsung or whatever. We're talking about these pieces of office equipment that sit in nearly every organization that are hubs of information. Question.
Does that apply for a small, like, little office? Like, I buy a home, it's multifunction, like, fast, copy, does that apply to?
If it does those functions, yes.
Okay.
If it's just a printer, probably not.
Yeah, I have one at home and I bought it. It does fax, copy,
scan,
email. Scan. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Everything but cook macaroni and cheese, right?
Yeah.
Wait, what? Does it do that? That's the most important thing.
Yeah, you know, when your main food is rice-a-roni, it's pretty important, right? This is how to get a hold of me. I didn't think to bring like 40 business cards. I've got a few, but write that down if you want to get in touch with me. I'll reiterate that at the end of the presentation. And you could also say multifunction printer. I just chose multifunction device because oftentimes people put these pieces of equipment into their businesses and they don't use it for printing. Because we live in a date and age when we have the paperless office, right? Not the most sexy topic in the world, which is why you're here to find out more. I'm not really going to go in depth, but why talk about this at Linux Fest or Linux or however you say it? Who says it? Linux. Anybody? My boss insisted that it's Linux. I said, no, it's Linux. Why talk about it? Because the operating system is free, and the manufacturers have found out that the lower the cost of these things to the consumer, throw Linux on them. So nearly every multifunction device runs some version of Linux, or Android, or what have you. And the future is here. So, any questions? Oh, before I continue, what makes me qualified besides being a technician? I started learning programming in 79 in high school. Then I got my first computer in 81 from my brother for Christmas, a Radio Shack color computer. My dad's friend was an IBM salesman, and so one day I showed up at my dad's apartment, and there's a stainless steel computer about this high sitting in my dad's apartment. He was basically demonstrating it to the University of Buffalo in New York. It was the IBM PC before the IBM PC came. So I got to play with that thing, do basic on it. Then after after I graduated with a computer science degree, I went right to work in the computer industry. And so, you know, I've been doing this for a long time. I've seen all kinds of printers and the, like you, like many of you, seen the progression of these devices becoming more and more networked, more and more a security issue. So that qualifies me to talk about these things, I guess. I'll start it up. Because we have a, if I had seen just two people in this room, I would have thought, eh, I won't play this game. But because it's a sunny afternoon, because it's just after lunch, because this isn't a sexy topic, I'm going to make you guys do a little bit of work. We're going to play a game. It's called the network game. It's going to take 5 minutes. I'm going to time you. So what the game entails is you go around the room swapping tear-offs with other people. You become software for a moment. You go, you tell somebody else what your software is, and they go, I don't know if I want that. Or, that's useful. I'll take one of those tear-offs. And you'll collect tear-offs, and you'll give tear-offs to other people. That way you'll, you know, talk to people for about 5 minutes. But you got 5 minutes to do it. And I don't know if there's enough tear-offs for everybody, but if you're left out, don't feel left out. But it's a great way to see how networking really exchanges information around society. So I'll just go around and pass one out. And when I say start, I start. But the rules are just keep exchanging, and you'll find out how much points you get at the end. And see if you win. Human beings, we like to win, right? Evolution has trained us. We want to come out on top. Unless you're a Christian scientist, then you still believe that. So these are arranged. The tear-offs have colors on them, so you don't know what the points are until I give you the cheat sheet at the end. And when I say go, you can travel around the room and say, this is what my software does. You want me? And somebody will say no. What does your software do? I don't know if I want that, but hey, you know what? That sounds sexy.
Right.
You'll get tired of that for a while. Hey, I have enough. You guys didn't think you'd have to walk around and you guys missed the intro, but your own risk. So let me explain again. Go around the room. Introduce yourself. This is my software. Do you want me? Yes. No. Don't accept the tear-off. But collect tear-offs in the hopes that you will win. Ready?
Could this be made-up software, or do we actually have to, like, hand our...
It's on the paper.
It's on there.
You are what the paper says.
Oh, wow.
Go.
All right, I am Red. I am a distributed DNS service that allows you to access DNS services. So it's a fully democratized.
Yeah, I'll take that.
I am the OS data.
Hello.
Oh,
yes.
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 I'll put it back.
You should be able to.
I'll just minimize it.
You can always go. Theoretically, mute should be able to.
Yeah, it's okay. Thanks. You were riding like Roy Don Royce, man.
Calculator on you, great. I trust that y'all can do basic math.
Holy crap.
If you can, if you are over 40 and have trouble, come close. There's the color, there's the points. Some of them are negative. I store keyboard entry data. In the words of, you know, the guy in charge nowadays, bad. Bad. But hey, I am voice recognition software. I change speech to text. Good. So count up your colors, points, and see how many points you have, and call it out.
My color's not up.
Yeah, you're off the bottom.
Yeah, we're off
you're off the bottom. What you got? Chartreuse? No?
Powder.
Powder.
Oh, it's at the bottom. Okay.
Negative five.
Negative five for powder. Sorry.
Boy, I made you guys do all this work. What's the payoff? I don't know.
So are negative numbers better or worse?
I'm guessing worse.
If
not playing golf.
Worse. Remember, we're sharing information. And software sharing information isn't always a particularly good thing, right?
Gray.
Gray.
Minus five.
Why?
You verify credit card information, that's why.
Scroll up to red.
I track service system suspects on the way. Oh, God. Oh, God. Unfortunately, we live in America, right?
Blue.
I change time zones. Plus five.
And if you've got them all counted up, let's hear some numbers. What's that?
Cinder. Yeah, I don't know who came up with this. Cinder's 10.
How about sand?
Green's 5.
Oh, I got 10 points.
Sand is 5. I remove red eye from digital photos.
Pretty innocuous stuff. Unless you are like some unscrupulous people who go take a $40 off coupon that expired in December and go into Paint and change it to December of 2018. Now you got $40 off. I've ever done that. 35. Anybody got higher than 35? 40. You got
40.
What do you got? 40. 40. Anybody higher than 40?
55.
Come on, let me see that. You got 55?
Yeah.
Anybody got? 45. Oh, I'm not going to prove it. But that means you make good choices. Anybody got into the negative? Don't raise your hand. All that means is that the software you chose is particularly harmful to society on the whole. So, I mean, I got this game not from computer science, but I was an astronomer in a year, years and years and years ago. And in our astronomy club, we did this game where we passed around little pieces of paper, and one of the pieces of paper was AIDS, and how many times you came in contact with AIDS, you know, meant that your chances were likely that you were going to get the disease, right? But there was one virgin among us who didn't choose that card, and they're like, hey, they won the Cupid doll. There's no Cupid doll today, but kudos for 55.
That just tells you that anything connected to the network is susceptible, right? You knew that already, but that drives it home. So why are we talking about this? Because it's connected to the network. And these are some of the things that occur. And we'll talk about each of these in turn, but unintentional change is the big one, because let's face it, these things are wide open when you get them out of the box. I just got that thing out of the box. I set it up with no security. It's just bland milk. White toast, and somebody comes along and says, huh, I can scan to the network? How do I do that? Well, download the system administrator guide. Oh, username and password is in the guide. I've downloaded it from the internet. To get network scanning going, I need a folder on the network drive that's shared with full control. I can do that, and so on. And you can see that quickly, this machine is gotten out of control at the hands of systems administrators who are supposed to lock it down, right? Or, if it's a much bigger machine with really good resolution and it's color, and you can go down to Bison Bookbinding and Letterpress downtown and get some really nice cloth paper, fiber paper that kind of resembles, you know, the paper that we print this stuff on, and if you get the little ribbon, the little translucent ribbon that you can iron into it and print some money off that device, you know, if you've been eating Rice-A-Roni for the last couple of months, maybe you can treat yourself to Keenan's on the Pier, you know, pass off a few 20s, your server will be really appreciative for that big tip, and you make your way out the door and nobody's none the wiser, right? Fraud happens. Theft. These things come with, lo and behold, hard disk drives. Really quite accessible.
Wait, they're not using NAND?
What's that?
They're not using NAND storage. They actually have like a hard disk in there?
Oh yeah. And NAND storage, yes.
Oh, okay.
We'll get to that in a minute.
So it's like a NAS built into the thing?
So fraud and unintended use, those are really big. Theft, not so much. Maybe after the fact, we'll talk about that. Sabotage, there's nobody really like Office Space that takes a baseball bat out to these things, you know. Of course, there are people who misuse these things. They scan their let's face it. But they don't have a multifunction device at home, so they bring their receipts in, scan them all, or their taxes, they bring them in, scan them all, and where do they end up on the hard disk drive, right? or that's a matter of fraud, right, or theft of the company. But sabotage, it's more like somebody comes in and says, oh, they're firing me today, it's a Friday, everybody's leaving, and I am just going to send a print job to every single printer in this damn building that prints full coverage black, or full coverage green, or full coverage burgundy. I chose those colors on purpose. To every color machine in the building, I'm gonna load them all up with paper and use up all their consumables, all their toner, and Monday, they'll be none the wiser, but eventually they'll get a bill for a couple of $1,000s for all that usage, and I'll be out the door, way down the street at the competitor's place. Sabotage. It happens. Because people are disgruntled employees, you know. So, here's the details. Why is this important? Because these things out of the box, and often, for years on end, just sit unsecured. They're vulnerable. If you're an IS person, go ahead.
So, you may be covering this, but when I look at the manuals, when I set these up, I don't see anything, any chapter on securing your device. Where do you get this information?
Yeah, and I'm only familiar with Xerox. I'm not familiar with the other brands, but the System Administrator Guide is a good place to start. But like every bureaucratic organization, try to find that in the manual. It's like hidden, or it's called something else. For instance, wiping the hard drive. We all know the term wipe, but what else can you call it?
You mean like with a cloth?
With Department of Defense seven overwrites, you know. What do you call it? You know, it's called something different by everybody, so you have to be versed in this. So if you haven't been in the field for long, you might have to, you know, knock on the cubicle next to you and go, it's like, well, what do we call this? And find out where you hide that feature. And then, so there are just maybe three or four features that we're gonna, that are useful for locking down the machine, and hard disk drive is one. Yes?
I've been noticing, I don't know if you're gonna cover this, a lot of embedded Linux devices coming around, but they're already really antiquated kernels, like the 2.4 series. Is there a reason for that? Is it like easier for them to just go from like legacy kernels over compared
not
to, like,
easier,
you know,
more cost effective. That's the bottom line.
So just using like the 2.4 series, which is EOL, but they're shoving them in 2016 routers. Is that cost effective to them? It just seems weird.
There's also patents. Just like the grocery business, there's very thin margins. If you're going to be a grocer, everybody's competing against everybody. How do you make money? You just buy a competitor and use debt leverage to make it look like you're growing as a business instead of actually selling food. So copier and multifunction device manufacturers, they're competing fiercely with each other, and they have patents that keep them from, prevent them necessarily from using the same stuff on different machines. Until those patents wear off, and then everybody can call themselves Xerox, right? Because Xerox is now not a brand name; it's just a generic name. And Xerox fought desperately in court to try to get people not to use the word Xerox, right? It's so ironic. But yeah, to answer your question, they use old stuff because it's cheap,
and maybe because they've done it in older devices, they don't have to pay it.
And they're trying to shove a new model out the door, and the engineers just said,
we
this is a low-end machine, let's just put it in.
Well, the other thing, too, there is, I mean, the 2.4 kernel was a lot smaller than the 4-point-whatever kernel. So, I mean, on a small device that's probably running, like, an old, you know, like, when I say old, I mean, like, probably, like, a 20-year-old RISC design, you know, with, like, maybe three or four devices.
As you know, running RV8 processor.
That's a great
2.4 series with, you know, 512 megs of NAND storage, and they just shove them in.
There's
ARM is a pretty old architecture. I mean, ARM V8 itself is new, but I mean, it's not. You don't need the latest Intel microcode, right?
No.
So I mean
they're ARMs.
Let's move on. These are appealing targets, no doubt. Attacks aren't always malicious, but again, these things are a cost to the organization. And every time, even a legitimate user goes and prints color, for instance, somebody down the line is going, we're using too much. And some administrator's trying to put the kibosh on your use. So, I mean, imagine somebody who's really disgruntled and just wants to print color all day, damn the torpedoes, full speed ahead. You could also make these things run backwards and harm the gears, but the hard disk drive. Once this thing leaves the building, it's free game. We're gonna look at a little video that CBS did in a little while, and it's gonna hopefully, if you don't soil yourself, I hope that you do, because it's happening all the world over. And this, to a great degree, if you're in an organization that says secure the damn devices, it's your job, right? If you're the security guru, and so if you don't, who do they come to blame? You. And again, at product end of life, these things are often resold, and it exposes the device. It exposes, because what is, in this day and age, information is power, right? And so the more you have of it, and the more you can sell to somebody who's looking for it, I mean, your credit card information is 5 cents on the dollar. Anything beyond that, bank accounts, social security numbers, maybe 10 cents on the dollar. And if you're a high net worth individual or an organization that activists really want to bring down, like, I won't say, you know, some oil refineries.
Girl Scouts.
Planned Parenthood. Then you become a target, and anything that leaves the building is a potential threat. Okay. So what is it about these devices that you have to secure? First, the actual device. We want to keep people from coming up, punching in nothing, and doing something with the device, right? Where this thing connects, well, this is a fax cord, but I will plug in my network cable shortly. Shortly meaning right now. There it is. And now it's available to anybody who can get past your router's firewall, get past maybe your server's permission settings, and boom chakalaka, it's off to the races for them. So, encryption of the hard disk. If you're in the government, you may have to comply with FIPS 140-2. What the hell is that? It's just encryption. But it's also digital certificates and servers checking whatever device attaches to the network. Are you supposed to attach to the network? No, you can't. The documents themselves, things that you scan here, can be what? Password protected and encrypted. So ensuring that there's no man in the middle. If they can intercept the document, then they can't read it.
As long as the password isn't guessable, right?
And then again, the hardware itself. Physical access to the hard disk drive. I've got a Kensington lock on here. It's not attached to any heavy object like a table or the wall. But what does this do? It just thwarts people from making off with the thing. Thwarts people from opening the container with the disk drive in it, which I'll do in just a second. So CBS News, aired a segment years and years ago, warning of the dangers of hard disk drives. Why would anybody want to access a hard disk drive? Because there's images on it. Anything you scan, anything you print, anything you can save directly on the hard disk drive. For instance, let's say you're an employment agency like Express Personnel Professionals up on Meridian, and you have forms on the MFD. Instead of interrupting the receptionist to print off a form, you just have a kiosk there where anybody can come up and print out an application form right from the MFD because it's on the hard disk drive. There's no personally identifying information on there, but maybe there is, so something to consider there.
So when you send a print job to the printer, it's saved first to the hard drive before you actually print?
It's saved somewhere, if not the hard drive.
Okay.
But it could, if you tell it to. Different manufacturers have different methods.
Okay.
And so they may...
So a user doesn't tell it to save it, you say print. So you're saying it actually saved to the
You could.
Storage.
Instead of printing, you could say save. You could say delay the printing until after hours so that you come in the morning and your print job's sitting on the output tray. Another hole, right? Sitting on the output tray. Let's look at this for a second.
I hope it takes me somewhere. Cannot locate. All right.
Google search.
Google search. Okay, I will. It might not. I'm not connected to the network. That's why. Silly me. Linux Fest CCS? CSS.
Thank you.
CSS.
Thank you.
CSS.
Thank you, CSS.
No, it's just thank you, CSS.
Oh, thank you. I'm sorry. Try again. Thank you, CSS.
Yes.
Thank you.
First time I ever thank CSS.
Okay. So, the only news station I trust anymore. It's going to take a moment. Got to go through the ad. Five, four, three, two, one. And where's the sound? There's no sound. Pause. Where's the closed caption? Wait a minute. Thank me. Forgive me for not being prepared with the sound. I guess, yeah. No. Is that it? Yeah, could be that. Thank you. I don't know how loud it is, so let's see. Might be me. No.
Do a bad lip reading.
Okay.
I think it's trying to pump the sound through the HDMI.
Let me overdub. Okay. So CBS News took a correspondent and they went to a expert in reading hard disk drives and said, "Can you get anything off these copiers that we went and bought from a reseller for $25 each. $25 each. And there's the guy. He pulled the disk drive out, plugged it into a standard off-the-shelf reader. It didn't take long to unscrew the 17 screws. This one, one screw. And this is the guy going and buying the equipment. Real easy. Hey, we got a whole room full. Yeah, equipment all day, every single day, boom. They just picked three at random. Plugged them in, had them shipped, plugged them in. It's not sexy, it's not awesome, but it is your information going out the door. Shrink wrapped. And they didn't have to wait long. There was already documents on the scanner.
Whoa.
That's where I'm from. I'm from Buffalo, New York. First thing they found was this copier was from the sheriff's office in Buffalo, New York. Right on the machine, they're pulling off information on felons.
You ever been to RAPC?
Where?
RAPC in Seattle.
BPC?
They have all these devices. Yeah, RAPC. You can go there. I've done tons of times. You can just go to one of their computers or like small devices that they have like the hard drives on. They claim they do. Tons of stuff.
Tons of stuff still there.
Always
they blacked this out just for purposes here. But another one they found was this is Ground Zero. That's the layout for finding out how to building the Ground Zero building, whatever that was called, checks. People scan checks. So you can get routing numbers off of that, account numbers off of that.
The last one, the good one, was the healthcare place. So people's healthcare histories, social security numbers, you know. Why is this stuff useful? Not to you, but there's people out there, unscrupulous people, who will go file your federal income tax return as you. Anybody have that happen to them, by the way? Happened to my boss. And it's going to happen more and more. One in five people are bound to get their information lifted in this manner. In this manner. I mean, it's just like we're just going buying stuff for $25.
Yes, sir. Checking the audio problem. No problems. Are you sure?
Yeah. They contacted this healthcare place saying, hey, secure your devices. Did you know we've got your information? We're taking necessary steps. And sure. So what necessary steps are they taking? They're probably telling their people to lock down our NFTs before they leave the building. So enough of this.
Billions of dollars are just leaving the building, right? You can look it up on your own. This example here was UC Berkeley students were trying to store songs on the copier disk drive. You know, just playing around, trying to defeat the system. And you can do that if your device doesn't have something like, it's called different things, but integrity control. So it's constantly monitoring the system to make sure that nothing associated with printing, copying, scanning, faxing is going on the machine. So MP3 file is not going to make it onto the disk drive if there's integrity control involved. It looks at the MIB, the machine information base, and says this is allowed and this ain't allowed. There's a whitelist, basically.
Can't you defeat that on some systems that implement it very poorly?
You sure could. Next. So this, I just talked about this. So embedded device control software, whatever you want to call it, prevents unauthorized read and write, prevents unauthorized adding of files, restricts files updaters. What's a file updater look like? It's one of these. So most companies, I would say most companies now, are saying no to USB flash drives at all in the building, let alone putting them into a machine. Because, you know, these things are hypodermic needles. Anything could be on them. In fact, one tactic of bad guys, of black hat guys, is to throw these things in a parking lot. Mm-hmm. People pick them up, even seasoned professionals pick them up and go, wonder what's on this. Plug it in. Bad. Sometimes the seasoned professional has a laptop not connected to the network. They plug it in, and they have a sandbox just to see what the heck's on this. Is it anything bad? Who's trying to get into our system? And, you know, kind of throw it back at the fraudster.
Aren't they now emulating kid devices on the shape of USB thumb drives? Like, you put them in? Is that a thing?
Emulating them?
Yeah,
anything's possible.
Like a virtual hit device, so it can like control the mouse and keyboard as if that was an external mouse and keyboard when you plug it in.
I suppose so.
Yeah, there's a device called Rubber Duck.
Oh, Rubber Duck,
exactly,
that's what
that.
It is. Okay.
You can also rewrite the firmware of thumb drives.
Yes. Thumb drives are used in the field by service technicians like me to update the firmware on these devices. And so, if you've got firmware that's been altered that has some malicious software on there, it's enterable. If you have this embedded device control software, though, it could take an audit log and record what stuff is being done. And if it's your job to read the log and see what's taking place. Most of it's boring. Sometimes there's something on there that you should look into. Anybody ever hear of the book, The Cuckoo's Egg? The Cuckoo's Egg, write it down. Clifford Stoll is the author, Cliff Stoll. He's also from Buffalo. And he was just investigating. He worked at UC Berkeley as a computer guy back in the 80s. And his boss bought him an accounting error in the system. This is when people had to pay for time on the big computer. The accounting error was 75 cents. 4 months later, he's still tracking this guy who's hacking into their system looking for things like nuclear codes, radioactivity, search keywords like missile defense. And eventually, Cliff, starting from a 75 cent accounting error, was able to trace this guy to somebody in Germany who was working for USSR at the time.
Soviet Union. So you never know where the attack's going to come from or where it's going to lead, but if it's recorded in the log, it may be traceable. If you call the FBI, they'll say, if it's nothing less than $500,000, we don't look into it. So good luck. How do you prevent this? Schedule the disk drive to overwrite things. Security scenario 2. A web hacker gained operational access to over 150,000 printers. I'm not going to look at this. It's an article. It's not a video. But what he did was he took over the printer and he just printed out a "haha, you're being hacked" page, one page. Friendly hack, basically. But imagine if it was an unfriendly hack, printing out just page after page after page. Sometimes I've come across printer drivers that are old that when somebody sends a PDF to it, it just keeps printing gobbledygook in the top, and it just keeps printing, and it prints 1,000 pages before it runs out of paper, and people come in the morning, and it's like, what the heck happened? And, you know, that's not what I'm talking about. I'm talking about purposeful taking over the machine. But why else could it be bad? Printing out stuff that's incriminating of an internal employee. Hey, John's been looking at kitty porn. And I don't mean kittens. And John is the CEO. And so, you know, opened a big can of whoop-ass on that guy, or girl, Jane. Print fraudulent documents. So print off something that needs somebody's signature. You know, social engineering that makes somebody sign something and fax it back. They're none the wiser. It's like, oh, that was just a purchase order, a purchase requisition for something. And now somebody's got a signature on a document and they're buying stuff for themselves, right? Manipulate individuals into divulging information, because ultimately they may be after aggregate information in which to just file tax return after tax return after tax return and get this money for themselves, right? And then that scenario that I had mentioned earlier, that's kind of a sabotage and cause the device and operate in such a way. This is basically taking a hold of the system software, the firmware, and making the machine operate in a way that it wasn't intended to. Grinding gears, making the fuser melt paper, things like that, and destroying the machine as a way to get back at the organizational bigwigs. Anybody have any questions here?
Has there been a case that, like, a place has burned down or, like, printers exploded and hurt people from, like,
WorkSource, right down on Prospect Street. It was our copier. I don't think it was our copier. I think it was the outlet that the copier was plugged into. It wasn't wired correctly. And smoke started billowing out the building. It's like, man. And it caused a lot of smoke damage, but it didn't, you know, nobody was killed. No equipment was burnt down.
But these could potentially burn down entire businesses.
It could. I mean, okay, we're also talking about IoT, Internet of Things, right? This is an Internet of thing, right? And if you can break into it and it's got, you know, a heating coil in it, basically, that can be made to keep heating until it passes the thermistor's value and keep heating until it melts, that roller starts melting the plastic, and it's not quite a nuclear meltdown, but it's hot enough to make that thing catch on fire. It's possible. I've not heard of it, but I mean, if we're talking about hacks to the power grid and hacks to electrical or natural gas utilities and stuff like that, it's bad stuff. And you're one of the lines of defense if you're in charge of securing these things. So how do you prevent that? You can exclude people from using this device after hours. That's one thing. It's common among some of the organizations I put these things in. You can change ports so that people have to guess and guess and guess and guess to get through. You can put account codes on. Now, this really bothers users, right? Because they have to come up and touch the screen and enter a code. If you've got a card trace reader, you could find out, for instance, whether this needs an RFID card to get access, and find out what card is necessary, what code is necessary on the card, and make your own card and get in.
this, there's no RFID reader on this machine because it didn't come with it, but this would be where it goes. Just plugs into a USB, another potential place to plug in and start reading information besides the front port. Where is it? Over there. And there's one on the back as well. I lied. There is a 9-pin port on the back. I never noticed that. Okay. So access cards with money built into them, often you find them at schools. So students can print, but not to their heart's content. They reach a limit. It's like, man, I really need that research paper printed out. And then they have to go to some admin to issue them 50 cents to print out that. But it protects the information on the machine. Prohibited originals. So yeah, you can copy money. I had an attorney whose main function was copying cash because they, you would think, oh, you can't do that. You can't. You're not supposed to. But with their old copier, they could. But the new one they got prohibited them. In fact, it kind of looks like this. Where is it? Image files. Prohibited originals. So this is what you see at the copier. You tried to copy money and you couldn't. So the attorney was trying to copy money because they're trying to prove that people were paying their child support and they got the receipt for the child support. And then suddenly they can copy money. So the workaround is copy it at 150 times the size, 1.5 times the size, or 75% of the size. That gets around it because the FBI will be alerted. No, the FBI doesn't really care. It's, who is it?
Secret Service,
right. They care. And incidentally, we live in a border town. Who knows what the biggest counterfeiter is? Probably in the world. Anybody?
North Korea.
Yes. 20s coming out of there like gangbusters, passing through our border, coming here. But you too can be a counterfeiter. So what can you do? I look at these things as they go into a business, they get used, and they come out. Where are the pain points for the customer? Right when they get it, configure the device. Print out or keep a checklist of what you've done. Keep the configuration sheet. It doesn't look sorry. It's not much. There's a config sheet. It just tells you things like the firmware, the serial number. They can be double-sided, and then write on them, write passwords on them, file them away, and you're safe. Ah, they're safe. Identify who's going to use this machine. Okay, there's turnover in organizations. If you change, for instance, the admin passcode, and you write it down somewhere, and you file it away, nobody will ever find it again. There's another person that you have to be aware of when the machine breaks or needs service. A service technician comes in, they try to enter the admin passcode to alter the firmware and they can't get in, so they call up the manufacturer and they reset the password back to what it was, do their firmware update, and hey, my job's done, see you later, and they leave with their bag. Ongoing, if there's change to the machine, keep a log of what changes have happened to the machine. It used to be that these machines would come with a little plastic thing on the back that you kept a log book. Nobody really does that, but you do it. Update the dock. Allow technicians access. So you might get a phone call. Hey, the technician's here to work on the machine. You can't get in. Give them the password. Yes. And after service, if they left it in a poor state or they left it with all the panels off, reload settings after service. This is the important one. Before this Elvis leaves the building, wipe the hard drive. Determine, where it's at before it leaves the building. Transfer settings to its replacement. It might not be the same make or model, so you might not be able to transfer everything. And you can set these things back to set factory defaults through the admin settings. Yes, sir.
I was just going to add how important retaining the HD is. My company, we always do the encryption, and then even though that should technically protect us, we always retain the hard drives and have them shredded. no matter what it costs to do that,
yep,
it's worth it.
So we had one customer, that's all they wanted to do was keep the hard drive. It's $99 a drive. So
yeah,
for some, hey, they don't care, just keep it. It depends on what the lease says. So if at the end of the life, the end of lease, it's going to be released, they might need the hard drive, I don't know. But you pay the manufacturer and it's okay, keep it. And it's a way to document that you've done your job, right?
Yeah.
Almost done. Oh, we are done.
I do have a checklist. I didn't print any out, but if you want it, it's kind of like a comprehensive list of everything you should check. And it's eye-opening because, you know, it contains things that we saw here, but it also contains information about how to, not how to, but what to look for. Because we got too much on our minds, right? It's not the top of mind. A checklist is good because, oh yeah, I forgot that. Boom, I've done it for this machine. I've got the serial number, I've got the date on there. Put it in the back of the machine, put it in file so that the next person who comes along knows what to do. And then I've got a survey here. Appreciate if you fill that out. It's for my purposes only. It might even, you know, tell my boss, convince my boss that, hey, people showed up at your presentation, they saw what you were doing. It's not necessary, it's not compulsory, and it doesn't go anywhere but my eyes, really.
Where
so
is that checklist?
I have it on my flash drive. I'll print a bunch off.
You have a printer right here.
I do.